How many years have you known Michael now?
Oh God, Michael, when I was fucking 10, we used to drive to Van Nuys to go train with my older brother Danny, and he was there training. I remember, it was at the gym where Ricky's at right now.
Another location,
in a house,
in a backyard,
a house made into a gym. Yeah, like the garage type of thing. And Frankie Duarte used to train there too.
Yeah,
remember Frankie Duarte used to train there?
Yeah, just hold that up. And
Frankie Duarte used to train there with us. I was like 10. And the Gorillas were amateurs already training there.
Where do you get stuff like that?
Probably any.
Yeah, that's what I was
Mike,
what are you doing with it?
Just Mike, do you remember the Big G and Robert when Robert was 10 years old?
Yeah. Oh, I remember like a little boy.
Okay, remind me, what was he like?
He was
same personality?
Kid. Hey, he was a very energetic young man running around the boxing gym. And
did he call you out for sparring?
No, I don't think he did. I mean, he was only, 10, 11 years old, and I was 21, 22, so there's a big difference in age, height, reach, and experience.
You know, one thing I remember, and it was, we used to leave the gym before we left, and he was always in the grass area with a water hose.
And we would water myself down.
And we would think, you think that's like his shower after the fight, or does he go home? Like we would question that, or does he go home?
Well, ask him right now.
Joe Goose used to kick my butt in the gym, I needed some cold water.
Yeah, I remember after training, he would always go to the
water hose. And that was our first gym back in the 80s, and it was like a makeshift gym, but it was a gym that always got me prepared, and the rest of the guys, the Ruelas brothers, Frankie DeWardy, and guys. So, hey,
the gym was amateurs by that time.
They were fighting the silver gloves.
Yeah, they were still fighting. Yes, yeah.
Hey, props to Joe Goosen for taking the Ruelas brothers. It's like Big G took Robert, Mikey, and Fernando from zero to championship.
Kudos to Joe Goosen. I mean, look at all the world champions he worked with. Yep. I was his first world champion, I want to say.
Wow. And then,
you were his first world?
I was the first world champion, yeah. Wow. You know, Joe's worked with some great fighters. And,
he's a very positive person.
He's very positive, and he's one of the best boxing trainers to date.
Yes. You know what's crazy, Mike? Listen, it's my first time sitting down and talking to you. You're such a nice person, such a positive person. People don't know your life and where you've been 5 years ago and 10 years ago and 2 years ago. They wouldn't believe it where you were.
Well, it just goes to show when you get elevated and intelligent and civilized, you got to become smart, because if not, they got places for you to be. And, you know, I like my freedom, and I'm ecstatic to be home, and I'm trying to, you know, do the best I can do and be the best I can be.
But, but here's the crazy part. I'm going to tell people a little synopsis. This is about 20 years ago. Uh-huh. It's a thing called entrapment. It's a famous law where they set you up, and they put you in jail for 20 years. And
well,
I looked at your case, and any lawyer would have got you off with nothing.
Well, you got to understand, you know, who knows who the lawyer's with. They might have been with the government. I don't know.
They set him up, Robert, and it was a deal gone bad.
They can never set you up if you don't do nothing to make them set you up. So, you got to take responsibility for whatever you've done. And I'm a stand-up guy, you know what I'm saying? See, I didn't go to jail. And, you know, want to inform to the government or nobody else.
Straight out.
I would done my time like a man. I come home like a man, and I stand tall like a man.
No, of course, but 20 years is a long time.
No, it was 24 years.
Sorry, 24. And listen, I was following your case in there. They didn't treat you nicely. Well, it wasn't a good situation.
Well, you're never in a good situation when you're up under the arm of any prison system, because that's is designed to break you down. And I'm a very strong-minded individual.
You're a champion.
Yeah, and they couldn't accept that, you know what I'm saying? And then they'd go home and tell their wives or girlfriends or their friends, well, I locked this guy up today or something. You know, those guys, look here, I get more recognition and respect out of anybody. I mean, my name is known all over the world, so no matter what they've done, hey, they've done it, it's over with. We're looking forward,
absolutely.
We don't look back, you know what I'm saying? And,
in life, you punch up, not down.
Yeah, that's the thing about it, you know what I'm saying? And we keep swinging.
What's your message to anybody that's locked up right now that doesn't have the hope that you had?
Well, my thing is, just have a good family support, and just have people you can believe in, and believe in God, because He's the only one gonna let you out. Because they're not gonna let you out. You know what I'm saying? They want you to do that time, brother. So my advice is, don't go to jail, because you know, if you enjoy your freedom, it's not no place to be.
How popular is boxing in there? A lot of people were fans of yours.
Well, you got to understand, you're gonna have some guys that like you, some guys not. It's just like in the streets. You know what I'm saying? I mean, hey. You know, some guys gonna like you, some guys not. But when they meet you and see what type of guy you are and see your character, they change their perspective. You know, I met, you know, organized crime figures. I met street guys. I met successful businessmen. I met, you know, hard heads. I fought different groups of guys from different gangs. You know, the Bloods, the Crips, the GDs, the BDs, the Foes, the Moes, the Aryans, the Mexican mafia. So, you know, I mean, you know, in prison, when you're in federal prison, you got to understand you're going to be around a lot of guys, not just from your state. I'm from the state of Iowa, but unfortunately, I'm in the federal penitentiary. So, you know, they ship you all over the country, and you're with guys from different parts of the world. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you can be from anywhere and be in federal prison. You can be from Russia. You can be from Cuba. You can be from the Dominican Republic. You can be from Czechoslovakia, Yugoslavia, Paris, France, and all parts of the United States. So, you know, it's a big place.
So what kept you positive in there?
What kept your hope up? My family and, you know, the support system that I had, man, because, you know, it was something I knew I had to do because I couldn't get to prison and climb up, you know, and not be the man that I was. You know, you got to go. I got a saying, it's called 10 toes down. And I stand 10 toes down no matter what I do. I stood 10 toes down in the ring, and I'm going to do it in prison. I'm going to do it in the streets. Wherever I'm at, I'm going to be 10 toes down. And I'm going to be a man. I'm going to give respect, and I'm not going to take no shit. I'm not going to start no shit. And I'm going to just, you know, be the man that I am.
Could you box in there at all, or shadow box?
No, they told me I could, like, work out while I was in prison as far as just being in the room by myself, because guys would stand outside the room and just watch me, you know, do my thing. And even officers would come by and, like, this fucking dude's a monster.
Because, Robert, you know, they watched him shadow box. They're like,
they would watch me shadow box and do my thing. They didn't want me doing it with other guys, which I understand, because, you know, if I show you how to throw a left hook, what you want to do? You want to go outside, you want to execute that left hook. Well, the champ showed me how to throw a left hook. Next thing you know, you're out there knocking guys out. And what the federal government was going to do, they were going to enhance my sentence.
Okay.
And give me more time.
No, we don't want
lock
that.
Me up. So I just say, hey, man, I'm not training nobody.
Who's the most famous person you met in there?
Yeah, I met a lot of people, so I don't want to do no name drop. But yeah, I met a lot of people. When you say famous from what? Because you had a lot of street guys. You had organized crime figures. You had celebrities.
Celebrities.
So, I mean, I don't want to call these names because, you know, a lot of times, you know, they don't mean
much. But it surprised you that they knew who you were?
No, never really surprised because, you
were in L.A. many years. And, yeah.
You know, you had a big name. So anytime you got a big name, the guys that don't know you, you know, you got different groups of guys. They're going to say, hey, that guy's such and such. And so, you know, it's not, it's hard to go unnoticed in federal prison when you got a big name.
Absolutely not.
Plus, not unless you in the shoe where you can't come out to the compound. But only time I was in the shoe when I got in trouble. I had an actual protection when I got to the jail. You know, I'm my protector.
How did you deal with the food in there? Is it edible?
Well, you know, you got to understand, I was eating a meal called Common Fare, so it was all clean, good, healthy food.
Good.
I wasn't eating off the line because I just never, you know, really trusted the food. And, you know, it was just my opinion. I ate clean.
We fast forward 24 years of hell. You come out, and you're ready to fight right away. Like, no break, no time. No, you called Joe. You said, Joe, get me a fight.
Well, yes, I did, and, you know, I mean, if they can get me a fight, I'll fight. You know, my thing is, hey, you know, if I never box again, you know, I've had a great career. It was illustrious, and, you know, I was able to, you know, fight different world champions and not only
fight. And look, just by hearing him speak, he's a very smart man.
Yep.
Very smart man, speaks very well, you know, so, you know, that tells you his career was very good, you know, didn't
get punchy.
Well, thank God for that. Way. I used to tell people all the damn time, I still punches hurt. They look at me now. You don't look like no fighter. You know what I'm saying? I'm 58 years young. 58 years young.
Wow. And I thought you're 48.
When Joe Goosen seen me, Joe said, what the fuck are you doing? Because Joe trying to live right, do the right thing, and take care of himself. Because
he's 58, you know. Yeah. He looks 48.
And oh, well, I mean, it makes me feel good when people see me. They're like, you how old? I said, 58. Because a lot of people tell me I'm older than you. I said, when was you born? I was born 1970. I said, no. I said, well, I was born in 63. How
are you older than me? But his attitude was so impressive. Because if I went to jail for 24 years for something I really didn't do, you could say you did it, but you didn't.
Well, one thing about it, you never say what you done or didn't do, because
correct.
That's what you do. Is they said I done it, and, you know, hey, that don't mean it's true.
Correct. But I'm saying your attitude is so impressive.
Well, you know, I think, you know, having good supportive people around you, it helps, man, because, you know, being in jail, man, is wishing on nobody, you know what I'm saying? You wish, you
listen, know, I went to traffic court. That was bad.
Yeah, well, imagine being in federal prison where everything is territorial. You know, like I said, you got different groups of guys from different parts of the world.
You
got
to watch the guards, watch your inmates.
You got to watch everybody, man. You know, all eyes is on me, and you just got to protect yourself at all times.
And they know you're a fighter, so they want to fight you.
There's no fair fight in prison, you know what I'm saying? You get to talking to a guy, next thing you know, he's going to put that razor blade or put that shank on, you know. You trying to square up like this here, and this guy got a 10-foot knife. He's waiting to stick it in you. So you don't go in prison trying to be tough. You just go there, and you mind your business. You stay in your lane. You don't take no shit, you don't start no shit.
To get involved on some of those gangs?
I mean, I'm not going to say nobody's going to force you to be in a gang. I think if you're going to be in a gang, because I got a lot of gang friends, you know, you're in prison with 99% gang members, so, you know, you're going to be in affiliation and association as far as talking to guys, and you don't bother them, they don't bother you, you know. I mean, you get in their business, they get in your business. So, I mean, you mind your business, you do your time, and you go home.
Yeah.
Because, you know, a lot of bad things happen in prison.
Right.
And
you remember Danny Trejo, the actor?
Yeah, I remember Danny, yeah.
He was in California. He was the penitentiary state boxing champion. They used to have boxing in jails here. Yeah. Imagine they had...
Did he play in American Me?
Yeah. No, you're talking about Almost.
Oh, they look the same with because of acne, but no.
Almost, yeah.
But you're talking dude with all the tattoos.
Yes.
He always playing the bad guy.
Yeah. Great dude. Okay. He came here.
I knew he was in prison, but I never knew he boxed.
Yeah, he boxed in prison.
Surprised, man. Yeah. Okay.
I asked him, like, what's your biggest win in prison? He said that the Army and Navy.
Coming home. Your biggest prison is coming home. You know, that's what, you know, I mean, understand one thing, man. You know, prison is designed to either make or break you, man. It's like when you go to prison, you got to make your mind up to you're going to come back out and do the right things and just really stay out your lane, because you can't beat the United States government. Well, if they want you, they're going to get you. So my thing is, hey, just stay out of their lane, man, and find something better to do, because if not, that's when they build prison. They got over 100-something federal prisons in the country. So don't think they ain't got a prison that can't hold you, because they got a prison that can hold you.
I see you didn't get any tattoos in there, huh?
I didn't get tattooed before I got in, before I went to prison.
Why not?
I mean, because they don't, you know, I don't knock tattoos, but I don't want to be pissing my body. I mean,
you don't put a bumper sticker. What did Mikey tell me? You don't put a bumper sticker in a Bentley.
Yep.
And plus, everybody recognized me for who I am. So I think I built a big enough name or whatever to be recognized. I don't have to have no tattoo. You know? I mean, you know, for the people that got them, hey, that's what you want. Do your thing. But I wasn't going to go to prison. Next thing you know, I'm coming out with tattoos all over my forehead, my face, and all over my body. And, you know, I know who I am. I don't have to, you know,
so,
I don't need that to.
So you're Michael Nunn, boxing legend, boxing icon. What's next for you now? You're free,
you know,
you're good.
What I want to do, you know, the most important thing, I'm home, my family and my friends and my peers and stuff. And just want to, you know, just continue to do positive things and, you know, keep your freedom and be able to do the things you want, because jail's not a place for nobody to be, you know. And like I said, when you get there, man, you got to make your mind up to what you want to do. You want to either stay, because they don't care. They'll keep you there all day, you know what I'm saying? If you're doing foolish enough stuff to keep you there, they'll keep you incarcerated. You know, and my thing was, you know, I was successful before I went to prison. Now that I went to prison and got out, I want to continue to be successful and continue to be the best I can be. That's always been my attitude. And I try to stay, you know, positive and focused and, you know, look at the good, because it's good that comes with the bad, and you just got to balance things out. Life's all a part of balance, you know what I'm saying?
When you first came in, you were a superstar. How did you adjust? It must have been night and day from the lifestyle of a pay-per-view superstar to now.
Well, it was, but it was something I had to do, because, you know, I couldn't sit there and, like, you know, just expect somebody to babysit me. I mean, when you go to jail, you got to man up, be a man, man, and you got to do your time.
How about a book?
Well, I'm in the process of wanting to do it.
You are? Okay.
You know, I'm going to talk to a few
like
people
in
the
picture. Like a series, like a Netflix, you know.
Yeah. Well, that, you know what I'm saying?
You have a good story, man.
A great story. Now, hopefully we'll be able to utilize it and be able to maximize it and get some out of it.
Do you know Gervonta Davis? Are you familiar with him? Tank?
No, but I've been watching him. I like
25 and 0, 24 knockouts.
No, I like this kid, you know what I'm saying? You know,
great kid, great fighter.
Kid, no doubt about it. He seems like he's got some great trainers and a good a consistency of people around him. He's doing the right thing. And, you know, I like the kid. Every time he fights, I want to see him, you know what I'm saying? Because
so
I like him, man.
His coach has a punch called the penitentiary.
Oh, he does?
It's a short uppercut to the body, like you're getting shanked.
One thing about it, I know he's a very hard puncher.
He's from Baltimore, yep.
And he's putting his work in. He's one of my favorite fighters, him and Earl Spence.
Shout out to Earl. Canelo.
My man, Terrence Crawford, which is from the
Midwest. Oh, he's fighting Sean Porter. What do you think?
Next month. I think it's going to be a good fight, man. With, you know, you got one former champion fighting the champion. And, you know, if you want to beat the champion, you got to beat the champion. You can't talk about it. You got to be about it. So I think it's going to be a great fight, man. I'm looking forward to seeing it.
When you were in jail, were you able to watch boxing at all?
Well, in prison, you know, they don't really want you watching a whole lot of boxing, because you got guys betting on fights, and you got guys want to test their skills and think they see guys on TV fighting, so they want to execute on
the
opposition or whatever. So, you know, they didn't show a lot of boxing in the prisons I was in.
But were you interested in the sport? Did you want to follow it?
Interested in the sport due to the fact that, you know, I made my living boxing. And I was there to make a big name off boxing, and, you know, I always loved boxing. when I could see it, we would watch it, but they didn't have Showtime, they didn't have HBO, and they showed it on, I think, on Fox Network or ABC or NBC, we'd be able to see it. But
the Olympics stuff, yeah.
Things of that nature, you know what I'm saying? But there's not a lot of fights being shown in prison.
That's fine.
Your Olympic, you were the Olympic alternates, but your Olympic teammates were Evander Holyfield, I think Lennox.
Mark Breland. Henry Tillman.
Shout out to Henry Tillman.
Who?
Mike Tyson was alternate?
Mike Tyson, we both was alternate. Henry Tillman beat Mike Tyson to go to Olympics.
I remember.
He could only go to Olympics. He won the Olympic gold medal. And, you know, by Henry being from Los Angeles, that had to be a great feat because he was born and bred in Los Angeles. And then for him to represent the country and then win the Olympics in the city that he grew up in, that was historic. A lot of people probably don't know that.
Riddick Bowe.
Beltrick Taylor.
Riddick Bowe, he come in. He was on the next Olympics. Olympics later.
He got robbed against Lennox.
Did he get robbed?
The referee took a point away for the headbutt. That never happened.
I understand, you know, it's a lot of political things going on in the Olympics. Fights went inside of the ring. They never fought as pros, did they?
No. That's why.
I think they shortchanged us by not being able to, you know, get it on. Both of you guys heavyweight champions, and I think it would have been a great heavyweight fight to put the two guys together because, you know, guys fighting amateurs and they turn pro, it's going to be a difference because when you fight an amateur fight, you only fight 3 minute rounds. When you fight for a world title, now they that's a 12 round fight. So you got to be conditioned to go 12 rounds. If you're not, you're going to get your butt handed to you.